The reality of the existence of the church, the bride of Christ, is to make Jesus known. And so whenever a church stops making Jesus known in their context, that's when it needs to go through revitalization.
Hello and welcome to Ministry Now, a resource from Southwestern Baptist Theological Seminary. Today I'm here with Dr. Kenneth Priest, who is an adjunct professor of church revitalization here at SWBITS, as well as the director of our Center for Church Revitalization. Good morning. Glad to have you.
Glad to be here.
So let's start with the bad news, because a church that needs to be revitalized obviously has been devitalized. So how does a church get devitalized?
Sure. So there's a number of factors that lead to a church needing revitalization. And quite honestly, there's a number of different, pathways to losing vitality in the life of the church. Mm-hmm. It could be something as simple as the loss of a pastor. Oftentimes in church growth, we talk about catalytic moments in the life of the church. So things that allow a church to kick off. Well, there can also be a catalytic moment and a downward spiral.
Yeah.
So a church goes into crisis, loss of a pastor, maybe it's over a moral failure. Maybe it's just simply time for him to move on. And the church was totally unexpected. And that can cause a setback. Oftentimes, though, it's a gradual drift. And so whether the pastor is a long-term pastor or new pastor, he comes to a realization that ultimately the congregation is no longer impacting their community. The reality of the existence of the church, the bride of Christ, is to make Jesus known. And so whenever a church stops making Jesus known in their context, that's when it needs to go through revitalization. You can look to Revelation for examples of this. The church at Ephesus is a wonderful church doing all the right things, faithful to the word, standing against false teaching, but they lost their first love, the gospel. So they were no longer impacting the community. Culture shift is the biggest issue. So we see communities in transition, the culture shift in the church. Of course, it used to be that you would look at a culture shift occurring about every generation, so about every 18 to 20 years. But as technology has escalated, culture shift is now in a 3 to 5 year window.
Yeah.
And we know this just by, you can look at your iPhone. It hasn't even been around for, about 14 years now. Mm-hmm. And we see how many iterations of it we have and how it has impacted the way we were even able to respond during COVID. Being able to help pastors, just they were able to set up their phone and start preaching right there to get online for their members. So that's an example of culture shift. So when these culture shifts are happening so rapidly, it leaves the church behind. You look at the education system. Kids nowadays, in kindergarten and first grade, they're given a computer or a tablet. When they show up to Sunday school, they're still given a book. Right?
How archaic.
And so it is. And so this culture shift that of we have a digital generation that is being matriculated through the educational system, but through our church system, we're still on an analog model. And so culture is leaving us behind. Therefore, the church is behind. Therefore, we start seeing this culture shift, drift, decline in the life of the church.
So you've mentioned the digitization of culture as one culture shift. What are some other ones that are external factors that might lead to the church sort of losing step
community? A lot of that. So, we can look in Texas as a perfect example of this, as our culture holistically, the nations have been moving to Texas. In fact, and I've not gone back and looked since the 2020 census have just finalized to fully evaluate all the data. But 2010 census, Houston was the most diverse city in North America. Yep. 75038 Valley Ranch was the most diverse zip code in North America. That's right here in Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. Houston, there was over 400 people groups in Houston. Over 110 of them could sustain a church because they were so large. They could sustain a church in their native language. And so when we look at the people group movement into an area, into a zone, that's a culture shift in itself.
Yeah.
And so we see say an Anglo church, a Hispanic church, African-American church, whichever. Predominantly, we see it in our Anglo churches where the community around the church changes, but the church doesn't change with the community.
Yeah.
And the local church is supposed to be a reflection of its local community,
yeah,
not of 45 minutes away and people driving in.
Yeah.
But unfortunately, many of the churches reflect where their people have moved to when they were here.
Yeah.
They no longer reflect here.
The community 50 years ago, 40
exactly.
years ago.
And so they are no longer a lighthouse of hope for that community. They're a lighthouse of hope for 30 or 40 miles down the road.
Yeah. So what, in that particular instance, what do you do when suddenly it's not even necessarily that the community is hostile, it's just different?
Correct.
What do you do?
Well, the shift we need to make in the church is to once again begin reflecting our community,
yeah,
which means it's time for changes in ministry. So what are the new ministry items we need to engage in, mm-hmm, in order to impact and reach this community for the cause of Christ? Not that we shouldn't be concerned about those 40 miles away. We need to be. But maybe that's a church plant we should engage in. But here we need to rework this ministry center in order to impact the lostness that's right around us.
That makes sense. So is it a matter of figuring out how to serve the community? Or is it more a matter of finding ways to bring that community, people who look like that community, into the church?
Yeah, it's never about bringing them into the church. It is about us serving the community. A natural overflow of serving the community will ultimately be they will come into the church. But if your goal is to bring them into the church, then you're missing the point of the church. Mm-hmm. The church is supposed to serve the community and reflect Christ. Christ was a servant. And we're supposed to serve the community we're in. And by serving them, we are creating the opportunities for them to engage with us. And then we can introduce them to our ministry at the church and get them assimilated into that model.
Yeah.
But not the existing model, a new model that we create to reflect who this community is.
What are some ways that churches in those situations need to change their models to reflect the community around them?
Well,
like some examples.
Yeah, that's the reality of the difficulty of each situation, right?
Okay.
So you look at urban, suburban, rural. We've got multiple different types of churches and therefore multiple different ministry models, mm-hmm, and multiple different culture shifts within each one of those contexts. So it really depends on where that specific church is and what it's trying to accomplish.
Mm-hmm.
Rural churches most often are maintaining a monoethnic model. Oftentimes it might be a bi, it might be dual, but you're really not going to see this multiplicity taking place that we would see in the urban context.
Just because there are fewer people groups in a smaller town.
Yeah, fewer people groups. I mean, you think about, you know, the community's got 500 people. Most of them were ranchers and farmers. They've owned the property. They pass it on from generation to generation. It's not likely many of them are selling off to others. And so you just don't have a lot of other people groups moving in.
Mm-hmm.
But if you do, it creates this subset of people groups. All right. So generationally speaking, we look at what we used to define. We'd have silents and boomers, and then you have your Gen X, and then your millennial and Gen Z. And we would look at all this and we'd say, well, boomers are, mm-hmm, XYZ. That's an overarching statement, yes, but for the most part, there's a reason stereotypes exist, and you can say those things. But by the time you get down to Gen X and Millennial and Gen Z even more, it's increased. It is no longer that you can look and say, African-American boomers this, Anglo boomers this, Hispanic boomers this. By the time you move to the emerging generations, what you have is, you have a melding of the mindset of that generation. And so they are more likely in tune with their generation than they are with their ethnicity background.
Interesting.
And so you get in a conversation with LGBTQ persons, and it doesn't matter if they are Black, Hispanic, mm-hmm, Asian, Anglo, none of that matters.
Mm-hmm.
Their framework, their people group is coming out of the LGBTQ. And so that's what your conversation has to drive for. But even outside of that, you see this happening in other, outside of those types of people groups, you see that happening within even the Christocentric groups, where you have the emerging generation Christians who have an adopted mindset as a group. It's this group think that's more likely than it is segregated based on their ethnic background and upbringing.
Someone in their 20s is more likely to think of themselves as a millennial than as a white person, maybe.
Correct.
At least how they conceive of themselves.
Correct. And they may not put that title on it, but it will be centered around a thought process. Mm-hmm. So whatever that thought process is as it relates to church, right? So what started with, it really didn't start with, but kind of flourished with Gen X and moved into millennials has continued to increase more and more is a separation of Christianity from the church, right? And so as you study the generations, there's I think Barna research released referring to millennials, the rise of the nuns, talking about those that have no religious affiliation. They're Christian, but they don't want to connect with a specific religious group in their Christianity. Therefore, they're separating from the church. They're, you know, the shift in that is Gen Z is pushing back toward the local church, but neither here nor there. The nuns is separating from the church. So we've seen this progressively go from boomer to Gen X to millennial to get more and more as a people group to separate. Well, biblically speaking, we know that you cannot love Jesus and not love the church.
Yeah.
That's very clear in scripture. And so that theological framework that they were championing was an undiscipled mindset and model, but it still was the thought process of the emerging generation. Mm-hmm. I can be a Christian. I don't have to go to church in order to maintain my Christianity and have a flourishing spiritual journey and walk with Christ.
So with that being one of the cultural dynamics we're dealing with in church revitalization, what has happened to cause that disconnect? Because it is, you're right that it is a flaw in our discipleship. So what are we doing in our churches that has got people thinking that they would be better off pursuing God away from the institutional church? What happened?
Right. Well, and maybe this is a better question for one of our church history professors to delve into, but experientially, what I've seen in dealing with the revitalization side of this is the separation occurs because of the actual lack of discipleship that exists in the church. We don't have a Romans 12, 1 and 2 being transformed the image of Christ discipleship methodology taking place. We essentially are teaching good things. Okay, so we go back to Revelation 2. The church at Ephesus stood against false teaching, so they knew the right things. But there was still something not transforming in what was being taught and what was being preached.
So what they're experiencing is sound doctrine without life transformation.
Correct.
Which is not exciting or compelling.
Correct. Really. Yeah. And so the emerging generations, as they see this, I mean, so their parents that are Christians get divorced. You know, why are they getting divorced if
The Bible says not to. Why are you doing it?
Right.
I'm confused.
So they see this and they say, wait a second, that's not life transforming. Therefore, and so it leads to these other issues. So when they start seeing all these issues, they see the church in conflict, right? So look around just a normal old school community. I think about the community that I grew up in, right? First Baptist begat Second Baptist.
Right.
How? Out of a conflict. Then Third Baptist came along. Where did it come from? Another conflict, right? Then you got Harmony Baptist or New Harmony Baptist. Where did it come from?
Ironically named.
Exactly. So all of these churches in conflict, the emerging generation sit back and look at this and they go, I don't want any part of this.
You say you're the body of Christ, but the body looks a little dismembered.
Exactly.
And if you're going to dismember it, if you can leave the church, why can't I?
So there's a difference between intentionally planting a work and missionally sending people out.
Yeah.
And church conflict sending people out to start a new work.
That is different. So it sounds like the work of church revitalization in our context today is, revitalization is a very good word for it, because it's not so much a matter of going in and starting something new. It's a matter of bringing something back to life that has gotten seriously off track.
Correct.
So as a pastor or a church leader, or even just a lay person, what are some of the early warning signs of church devitalization that can be red flags before the church is on life support, so to speak?
Yeah, so the statistics on this are really what we have to look at. The numbers bear you out, right? So again, when a church is no longer impacting lostness in the community, that should be a red flag.
How will you measure that?
Baptisms.
Okay.
If you have zero baptisms over the course of a year, you should say, wait a second,
something's
there's a problem.
Even if giving's good, attendance is up, people are in the small groups.
So 2008, 2009, we're leading up to the financial crisis, yeah, right? And churches were in decline, mm-hmm, but their giving was going up. And so the conversation that was happening in church revitalization at mm-hmm the time, what pastors were saying was, well, God's pruning back, but we've got the healthy people here because look at our giving. Money's going up. Well,
that is a factor.
It's not a real factor. It's actually a false identifier. Because your money's going up because the people that were faithfully tithing are making more money. We were in a growing economy. The same amount of people are giving as was giving before.
10%.
They're giving more because they're making more. It's not that you're technically getting more money. You're not weeding out. What's happening is you lost people that you never were discipling in the first place.
Yeah.
These people were not moving. So you've got to look at it from a pathways perspective. Mm-hmm. Discipleship becomes a pathways so that there's on-ramps. Mm-hmm. And so I'm going to take you as a new believer and begin to disciple you. I'm not going to expect you to give 10% on day one because you're struggling to make ends meet. You don't even understand discipleship. You just accepted Christ. You don't understand stewardship.
There's any number of discipleship issues that we're working on.
Correct. So we're going to grow you to that point. Well, that's an intentional strategy to lead you from 1% to 10% as we disciple you more into the image of Christ, right? Mm-hmm. Whereas if I just, you accepted Christ and I just kind of let you go, what happens, right? Well, again, the whole conversation, did you legitimately accept Christ in the first place? So this is the whole, you know, the seeds are out, are cast out. Some fall on hard ground, some fall on the rocks, some fall on the thorns, some fall on good soil.
Yeah.
So were you legitimately saved in the first place? Was it a transformational deal? No, that's not for us to decide. That's for God to decide. But if I don't do my part to disciple you.
Yeah. The signs of life are not there.
Exactly.
Leaving to God your eternal state, we can look at you now and go, this is not a healthy place for you to be today.
Exactly. So the whole issue for us in revitalization is going in and working with a church. And our model is contextualized under the framework of we work with the pastor. We believe in preaching for revitalization. Mm-hmm. But our focus is on the Great Commission, okay, evangelism and discipleship. You reach people and you disciple people. Mm-hmm. If you want to turn your church around, you go reach somebody for Christ and then disciple them. So a church that had zero baptisms for 10 years mm-hmm now baptizes one. Is that turnaround? Well, it's a movement.
It's a good start.
So the question then is, what do you do next? Well, you go lead somebody else to Christ. Mm-hmm. And then you go lead somebody else to Christ. But everybody you lead to Christ, you disciple.
Yeah.
Because we're called through the Great Commission to evangelism and discipleship.
Otherwise, people just come in the front door and right out the back.
Correct. So historically, you look at how we've done things in Southern Baptist life, and not being critical of Southern Baptists in this. I am Southern Baptist, born, bred, and raised, right?
But if you love something, you want to make it better.
Exactly. Historically, we try to focus on these two things separately. Right?
You can't.
So really. This year we're going to focus on evangelism.
Uh-oh.
Now this year we're going to focus on discipleship.
Uh-oh.
Now we're going to come back to evangelism. Now we're going to come back.
It's like trying to juggle with only one hand.
Right. The Great Commission is both.
Yeah.
You can't separate the two. Mm-hmm. You can because we've proven you can.
You can, but
churches suffer when we do that.
As anybody does, if you separate pieces, they're not alive anymore.
Exactly. So the reality is we need to tie it together mm-hmm in order to effectively accomplish the Great Commission. Therefore, preaching and the Great Commission is what our focus is on. And that's what our educational model is on here at the Center for Revitalization, the academic side of this that yeah we do, is making sure that we educate in that pathway as well. It's an integrated approach. It's not a separated approach.
As in, like, people come in, they meet Christ, and the immediate next step is now you're becoming like Christ.
Correct.
Part of becoming like Christ is leading other people to
Christ. We have a strategy for you. And that's kind of been the process. You know, I go back to when I was a kid, when I accepted Christ back in 1978. Mm-hmm. Several years after that, this little kit came out called Survival Kit, right? And so Survival Kit was put in everyone's hands as a discipleship method. Mm-hmm. And then after Survival Kit came Master Life, and then Master Life 2 and Master Life 3. And so you had this strategic plan. Now,
yeah,
some people criticize a university model such as that. However, if you can go back to Romans 12, 1 and 2 model, mm-hmm, how are you renewed in the image of Christ?
By the renewal of your mind. Transformation of your mind
So how do you do that? Except by engaging in God's word in a systematic plan.
Yeah.
Therefore, a study such as Survival Kit Meshel is perfect for that. So
yeah. creating, is it the only way? Maybe
it's
not. It's a way, though.
It's a way. But it has to be a part of the path, because we know Jesus by studying his word. Mm-hmm. We can't be discipled apart from God's word.
No.
And you need, oftentimes, a new Christian needs a pathway. And that pathway is a systematic plan. And
yeah.
so whether it is, I'm going to help you read through the Bible, here's a plan for that. And so what we do in Revitalization is read through the Bible in 100 days, not in a year. You do it in 100 days. The average person reading 45 minutes a day can read the Bible in 86 days. So we have a part of our Revitalization strategy is have the entire church read through the Bible in 100 days. The pastor preaches a 15-week series,
mm-hmm.
86 days divided up into 15 weeks, take one day a week off to catch up or a day of rest, turns into a 15-week series.
Mm-hmm.
And so you read the Bible in 100 days. The mm-hmm. pastor preaches the grand story of God from Genesis to Revelation in 15 weeks.
Which is not actually, that's unusual in churches.
Yes.
To get that.
Exactly. But that is the beginning point.
Mm-hmm.
of the foundation for a systematic strategy in discipling people for the purpose of revitalization. Revitalization is all about personal spiritual renewal.
Well, it, honestly, what you're describing, revitalization might sound very complicated, but it honestly just sounds like you're describing good evangelism and discipleship, also known as just basically discipleship, people becoming more like Christ.
Yep, exactly. That's what it is.
So in applying, so to revitalize a church, step one, you're saying, is we need to get really good teaching from the top down,
yep.
from Sunday morning,
yes.
Sunday school, small group, whatever particular structure, intentional biblical training, doctrinal training, so that people get in their heads what the Bible says.
Yes.
How then does the inundation with scripture wash over then into the kind of cultural shifts you're describing?
So for us, we believe in a sermon-based small group approach.
Okay.
Therefore, discipleship originates out of the pulpit.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, here at Southwestern, we're known for text-driven preaching. Therefore, we want to do text-driven preaching.
Exegetical, expository.
From the pastor in the pulpit.
Yep.
And then our Sunday school small group ministry is an overflow of that. And that's where the practical application comes in. And so the life application conversation, which is oftentimes what's missing. We have pastors all across this nation that preach good, solid, biblical sermons every single Sunday, but they fall short on life application. So the real question in the proclamation of God's word is, how is this relevant for me today?
Mm-hmm. I know that Ephesians 1 says X. What does that mean about what I do with my cell phone tomorrow?
Exactly. So what is it that I can take away from your message today that allows me to go out and live my life?
Mm-hmm.
As a regular congregant here in this church, how do I do this? If you can't show me how God's word is relevant for me today,
yeah.
then the reality is God's word is antiquated and out of date.
Which we know is not the case.
It's not the case.
But it's also very difficult on a Sunday morning in a
multi-generational, multi-ethnic.
There's 50, 100, maybe 500 people there. You can't.
Right.
Do all that. That needs
so
to happen.
How do I help senior adults? How do I help young adults? How do I help the married? How do I help the divorced? How do I help the widowed? How do I help the single?
Mm-hmm.
Each one of those people groups, those we have to shift our model to begin thinking about. These are all people groups within the main group of our local church.
And so it sounds like you can have a really awesome preacher and a really awesome pastor, but it sounds like if he doesn't have a team of people who are bought into this vision, who know what the Bible says and are able to exegete it effectively and apply it accurately, you're not going to revitalize the church.
Right. And the way that we address that is providing the resources and the curriculum to
yeah.
help the pastor because he can't do it by himself.
Yeah.
And the reality is our lay people are working 60, 70 hours a week and they don't have the time to spend in study like most of your pastors are going to spend.
Mm-hmm.
So statistically speaking, research has shown that growing churches, the pastor spends 15 to 20 hours a week preparing his sermon. Right. So if he's going to spend 15 to 20 hours a week preparing his sermon and the lesson is just as important,
mm-hmm.
they're not going to spend that many hours. So how can we accelerate their preparation time? So we provide the tools to help the pastor, to help the congregation, and doing a sermon-based small group approach actually helps with that
mm-hmm.
because he is discipling the people in the holistic strategy, 30,000 foot, and then he's allowing them to just prepare the life application side.
And they also are closer to the individuals they're teaching. They know
Correct.
Not just how do I reach out to these widows, but Betty, who's 97, and who's having conflict with her great-granddaughter, I know what Leviticus has to tell her about that today.
Exactly. Or at least they should, if we're doing this the right way. And so that's the idealized model to bring about revitalization.
Yeah. So it sounds like if we're looking at not just Southern Baptist Convention, but just the church in America today, these cultural changes have caused a disconnect between the church as an institution and the culture we're meant to be reaching, our neighbors.
Right.
And that revitalization is largely a matter of returning to Scripture with an understanding of it as something that affects all of life and addresses all of life in a holistic way, if you will.
Correct.
Revitalization is about bringing those two back together.
It is.
Showing how this Scripture changes your life today.
The pastor is supposed to be the cultural exegetical expert of his context. Okay. So he should be able to exegete his community and thereby exegete the Word of God into his community and speak to the people. And so his sermon should be driving that. And then the small group Sunday school environment should be asking those life application questions of how does this word really relate to what we're dealing with in our community context, with you individually and your life and what you're dealing with your kids, as you've got a prodigal child, you've got, you know, whatever the issues are.
Or even just a neighbor from a different country that
exactly.
I don't share a culture with. What does that mean? How do I deal with that? Well, the Bible has stuff to say about that.
Exactly.
Very interesting. I'm curious, kind of to wrap up, do you have any particular amazing success stories that you would share about, I saw this church, it was very dead, and now it is very not dead?
Yeah, I mean, we've got several stories of churches that we've worked with. Historically, when I say we, you know, I've been doing this for a few years and the center has only been around for a couple of years. So these are going outside of the work we've done at the center specifically, because we're just now getting started.
Yeah.
Revitalization is a minimum of a 3-year strategy. So we haven't been, we've been working with churches, but we haven't been doing it long enough to call a revitalized church revitalized. Mm-hmm. But historically, we've got several churches that we've worked with in the past. That we can point to as models of engaging in revitalization. And so whether it's the church that that was running 30, the pastor had been there for 18 years and had finally come to realization, you know, wait a second, we used to be 70 and we're a lot less now, we're 30. What happened? And then getting serious about reevaluating his community context, looking at the culture shift that has taken place, and then re-engaging in evangelism and outreach. So one of the things that we focus on in our pathways is not just the preaching and the sermon-based small group, but evangelism and discipleship. And so what are the items that you can do? What are the using the calendar to say, what can we do to engage our community and what's going to work here? And so I call it boomeranging, right? A boomerang, you throw it and it comes back, unless it hits its intended target. But you know, the theory is there. What is it that we can do in this community that will make people come back to us again? And so the late Roy Fish would tell us that it takes 7 substantive gospel conversations in order to lead somebody to Christ. Well, if we think about that, and if we shift our strategy and instead of trying to say, I'm trying to get you to come to my church immediately. But if I play the long game here and I develop a strategy that has you coming back and visiting us, whether it's our events outside or visiting something on our campus, out in the community, but sponsored by us, if I can continue to do that, and if I can make sure that we're presenting the gospel every single time at these events, whether it's a roving evangelist sharing the gospel or it's during an actual event presentation time, if I can get you back 7 times, statistically speaking, you've heard the gospel 7 times, more likely that you're going to receive Christ. Now,
if the person is being trained in applying Scripture, those engagements aren't just general, here's the Roman road. It's
exactly.
I care about you as a person.
Exactly.
And over those 7 plus times, that person is learning this group of people, they may be kind of weird, but for some reason, they care about me.
Exactly. And they're doing things for the community to meet the needs of our community. Right. So using children is the best illustration we could do this because you can, you know, do children's events all day. So you start with a back to school party. And at the back-to-school party, you advertise your fall festival. That's the boomerang. At the fall festival, you advertise your Christmas event. That's the boomerang. At Christmas, you advertise some spring event, mm-hmm. right? And at that initial or winter event, probably, then you advertise your Easter egg hunt or whatever Easter event you're doing. And then you advertise your out-of-school party. Then you advertise Vacation Bible School. And at Vacation Bible School, you advertise your back-to-school party. Mm-hmm. Well, you're just connected everything mm-hmm. for the entire year for the calendar for children. Mm-hmm. Well, generationally, if you do that throughout the year, mm-hmm. here's what we're going to do for this group. Here's what we're going to do for this. And if you're constantly letting them know what you're doing, mm-hmm. You're having these opportunities to bring people back. Mm-hmm. Ultimately, they're going to visit on a Sunday because you also tie these into Sunday. So you do Vacation Bible School. Mm-hmm. The shift that we used to do back when I was a kid, right? We got to get back to some old school things. Mm-hmm. Sunday morning was the time for the kids from Vacation Bible School to sing the songs. Oh. Well, churches got away from that. Mm-hmm. They started doing, oh, we're going to do family night on Friday night. Mm-hmm. Well, why? Sunday morning mm-hmm. is the ideal time. Mm-hmm. So you turn that Sunday morning back into let the kids get up and sing the songs and then let the pastor preach a sermon that's based off the theme of VBS. Mm-hmm. And you tell the parents, you know, your kids are going to sing. This is just like a school play. The kids are running. Who's going to come? Parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles, family, friends. Everybody shows up for the kids performing. And then the pastor says, and I'm going to share a message on what your children learned this week so that you know what we taught them. Mm-hmm. Right? The gospel's getting presented. Mm-hmm. Well, you find these opportunities to do that throughout mm-hmm. the year. Well, that's your Sunday morning invitation, yeah. and that gets them into the worship center on Sunday morning. So when we've done these things in churches, so again, going back to the church running, used to run 60, running 30, mm-hmm. they engage in this type of model, mm-hmm. and all of a sudden, somebody gets baptized, and then a couple more get baptized, and then a couple more get baptized. Well, within 6 weeks, 10 people are baptized. Well, that's a pathway to revitalization. Yeah. It's church growth. Ultimately, after 3 years, when you see continued sustained growth, mm-hmm. you see structure put in place that allows for continued growth, meaning new Sunday school small group units are created.
Teachers trained.
All of these things, leadership development is taking place. Mm-hmm. That's a revitalization situation. In that type of model, if the pastor transitions, the church can continue to thrive, not just survive. Mm-hmm. With the absence of a pastor, because they've created a model that is sustainable.
Yeah, there's a structure. There's a trellis for the vine to grow.
Exactly.
Well, plus, if what you're describing is happening, if what you're the kind of discipleship you're describing is happening at the pew level, then at the higher level, these events are going on. People are being invited. There are functions where people come together. But if the kind of discipleship you're describing is going on, then those same people are going to work, or going to their neighbors, or going to strangers and just having regular everyday conversations where their perspective on life is biblical,
right.
and the people they care about around them are hearing about it.
Exactly.
And so when someone is invited to Sunday morning, it's not just I'm going to hear my kids sing a cool song, which is great, but it's also I'm going to go hear my kid here sing a cool song, but I also know Fred and Amanda. And
exactly.
they cared about me when I didn't have money for groceries, or they just cared about me when I had a really bad day and a flat tire.
Exactly.
And that makes me want to stick around. Even if I don't know this Jesus guy yet, if these people look like him, I want to know more about him.
Exactly. They're very open to the conversation at that point.
It's very exciting. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Dr. Priest. This has
been
great.
My pleasure. Thanks a lot for having me.
Thank you so much for joining us today for Ministry Now. To learn more about the Center for Church Revitalization, you can go to swibbets.edu/CCR. You can learn more about church health consultations as well as training in church revitalization. Until next time, live your calling.